great revolutionary leader of Venezuela. And even though it's sad because he did die 2 years ago, we're here to commemorate and celebrate his life, his revolution in Venezuela, the Bolivarian revolution, and to commit ourselves here at home, not only for the struggle for justice at home, but in solidarity with Venezuela and its revolution, with the struggle in all of Latin America for sovereignty and independence. Hermanas y hermanos, aquí estamos hoy reunidos en esta plaza para conmemorar la vida de Hugo Chávez, el líder revolucionario de Venezuela, que 2 años hoy, en esta fecha, tristemente falleció después de sufrir del cáncer. Pero Hugo Chávez vive y la lucha sigue. ¿Por qué no decimos? Chávez vive, la lucha sigue. 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 Y entonces hoy lo dicen, lo llaman la siembra de Chávez, y estamos aquí en ciudades desde Washington, Boston, Chicago, Los Ángeles, San Francisco y Sacramento hoy, para denunciar la injerencia del gobierno de Washington, que está intentando derrocar al gobierno de Venezuela. Y decimos que estamos apoyando el gobierno de Nicolás Maduro, el presidente del pueblo de Venezuela, en su lucha para defender su soberanía. Y vamos a tener diferentes oradores a escucharles sobre lo que significa la vida, la leyenda, el heroísmo de Hugo Chávez. ¡Chávez vive! Gritemos para que todos oigan. ¡Chávez vive! ¡Chávez vive! ¡Chávez vive! ¡Chávez vive! Chávez nació el 28 de julio 1954 y él vivió con sus hermanos, sus padres y su abuela Rosa en el estado de Barinas de Venezuela. Era un joven de familia humilde. Sus padres eran maestros, pero vivían una vida de pobreza, pero una vida digna. Y Hugo Chávez, desde el principio de su vida, era un joven que se cuidaba de los otros jóvenes, y él nunca se olvidaba de los niños, sus amigos, que a veces tenían que trabajar en vez de estudiar. Y a los 17 años, Hugo Chávez se incorporó al militar, como muchos jóvenes que no tenían otra oportunidad hacían en Venezuela. Y él, desde muy temprano en el militar, en el ejército, él comenzó a organizar un grupo de oficiales y de rango menor, de un grupo que se llamaba el Movimiento el MBR 200, y el propósito de ese grupo secreto era de formar un equipo que podía desafiar a la dictadura de Carlos Andrés Pérez. Y en 1989, cuando el presidente de Venezuela comenzó a subir los precios de comestibles, de gasolina, la gente salió a las calles en rebelión, que se llama el Caracazo, en 89. Y desde entonces, Chávez, Hugo Chávez, sabía que era tiempo ya de organizar una rebelión de su grupo militar. Y el 4 de febrero de 1992, Hugo Chávez, en una acción tan heroica y con una visión increíble, con sus grupos de militares trató de derrotar al gobierno, la dictadura de Carlos Andrés Pérez, y desde entonces Chávez era un héroe. La gente en un instante conoció quién era ese hombre que luchaba por su pueblo, que luchaba por la dignidad, la justicia, las causas de su pueblo, y por eso fue elegido presidente en 1998, cuando tomó su presidencia en 99, el primer año de Venezuela bajo Chávez, tuvieron una constitución, la primera de 26 que Venezuela había tenido, pero la primera que la gente ayudó en escribir la constitución, y la primera constitución en donde el pueblo votó, aprobó con un porcentaje de 78% en apoyo a la primera constitución popular. Ahora vemos una Venezuela completamente diferente a lo que era antes, pero está bajo mucho ataque del gobierno de Obama y antes de Bush, es el objeto de los Estados Unidos, y por eso nosotros, gente de los Estados Unidos, tenemos que organizar, entender qué significa la revolución bolivariana, y ahora vamos a invitar a gente a venir a hablar. Por favor, quienes quieran.
The activists and at least here in the Bay Area, and I can tell you, a lot of people question or ask, well, what did Chavez do for Venezuela and Latin America? Why is this guy so famous? And you look at the country, the problems that Venezuela is having. Venezuela is not a perfect society with a lot of problems that we're facing. A lot of inflation. A scarcity of some goods. We're facing an economic warfare right now. And but what did Chavez achieve? When Chavez came to office, elected democratically, poverty was 55%. And when Chavez left the presidency, unfortunately 2 years ago, for reasons that he didn't want to, poverty was at 22%. And even today, extreme poverty is dropping. So, in spite of the problems that we're having. So, what did Chavez achieve domestically? Housing, 700,000 housing units in the whole country in the last 4 years. That is unprecedented in the country, in which poor people are forced to live in shanty towns and tin houses. So, what did Chavez achieve in terms of rights? Indigenous people, Afro-Venezuelans, had no rights in the Constitution. And thanks to the actions of Chavez, those people now have rights written in the Constitution. Women's rights, women's access to politics, to political power, women access to health, better health care. What did Chavez achieve internationally, you might ask? Why do people in Latin America love him so much? Well, for starters, Chavez, thanks to Chavez, we have regional integration in Latin America. 15 years ago, all Latin American countries were divided when it comes to dealing with the U.S. or with the European Union, with the world powers. Thanks to Chavez, we have institutions like UNASUR, the Bank of the South. We have a regional TV station to challenge the power of CNN and Fox News and so on, called Telesur. So, you know, I can go on and on, but at the end, people ask me, what is the biggest thing that you think Chavez achieved in your country and in Latin America? I think it was giving us back a sense of dignity and hope. Things are not perfect. The Latin America is a continent with a lot of problems and a lot of issues. And we have made a lot of progress. Poverty has certainly decreased significantly. Education has increased significantly. But we are way, there's a lot to be done in order to achieve parity with the so-called developed world. But what we can say that we have achieved is a sense of dignity and hope that things can be achieved if we really put our minds into it, that we can unite in Latin America. A lot of people for many decades thought, why is it that all these Latin American countries have the same similar interest? Why, when we go to the United Nations or to the Organization of American States, why don't we act as a bloc? And it was Chavez who helped us realize that we can do it. So hope and a sense of dignity is what we gain with Chavez. And that's why he deserves to be remembered. Thank you.
Martin, thank you so much. Someone from Venezuela who knows. I'd like to hear now from Carl Kramer from the committee in solidarity with the people of El Salvador, which just had a very significant election on Sunday. Maybe you can tell us something about it.
On behalf of the committee in solidarity with the people of El Salvador, we want to extend our solidarity to the path that the courageous people of Venezuela have taken to building a society that's free from domination by the 1%. It's for social equality, for providing everybody the basic needs and a living wage, health care, housing. And this last Sunday, the people of El Salvador went to the polls to vote for the members of the National Assembly. We have yet to get the preliminary results, and the final results probably won't be available until next week. The company that had been contracted to tabulate the results of the election had a technical breakdown, and their database does not have the capability for tabulating all the results. So now all of the from all the voting centers, the tabulation of the vote, what's called the OCTA, has to be taken to San Salvador, and it's being tabulated by hand. So we're waiting on hearing what the results are. This will play a big factor, and right now we have a government of Salvador Sanchez Seren, a FMLN activist, a grassroots leader, is continuing a progressive program that was started under the previous president, also an FMLN candidate, but now with somebody who rose up through the ranks of the FMLN and is accountable to the people's movement. So the programs have started providing health care to the people, housing, expanding education, eradicating adult illiteracy, and providing for the needs of the people. We'll be continuing, and with having more legislative seats in the National Assembly, will be expanded and better funded. So we're waiting to hear, how much more that the program can be advanced by the National Assembly, and how many more votes that they have in the legislature. So again, thank you for having us here as part of this, and for being able to express our solidarity with the people of Venezuela. I've been passing out leaflets. On Tuesday, March 17th, we'll have a report back from a couple of our delegates from San Francisco who went on the National CISPIS Election Observer Delegation. So they'll be talking about what they witnessed in the election. Thank you.
Buenas tardes. First of all, I'd like to remind everybody that this is the 2-year anniversary of the death of Hugo Chavez. Hugo Chavez, I work in Marcha Patriot together as a coalition of many groups in Colombia, and Hugo Chavez was the head of the Bolivarian Revolution in Latin America. He was the person who really was capable of bringing everyone together. Many people thought that way, but bringing the movement together against U.S. imperialism was not easy. It was a very hard struggle. In Colombia, which is the next door neighbor, we have a totally different situation. Colombia is the lackey, the largest lackey of all of Latin America, of the United States. It's being groomed. The rich and the famous of Colombia are being groomed to intervene in any movement of the Bolivarian Revolution that exists in Latin America. Hugo Chavez was absolutely the biggest enemy of the Colombian state. The Colombian state functions in name of U.S. imperialism very, very openly. It's not hidden. There are 7 U.S. military bases in Colombia. It's full of soldiers, it's full of money, it's got the largest per capita army of anybody in Latin America. And who's the army against? Against the peasants? No, I don't know. You know, the invasion, the idea of invading Venezuela was walked up and down the street in Colombia many, many times. It was announced on the radio. It was announced in the papers. Colombia is going to invade Venezuela because Hugo Chavez is the enemy of Latin America. It was very, very backed by the United States from the very beginning. But at the same time, the resistance in Colombia has grown, which is a really beautiful resistance. Because coming together after so many paramilitaries, so much U.S. intervention, so much repression, with millions of displaced people, 5 million displaced people, Venezuela came forth and said, "We are your friends. How can we help you?" They opened the doors, and the thousands upon thousands and thousands of peasants from Colombia who had been displaced and were threatened and their lives were in danger went to live in Venezuela, and they went to live in Venezuela along the border. They went in with health care. They went in with education. They went in with recognition by the state. They were legalized. That's what Venezuela did for the poor of Colombia. Many peasants in Colombia traveled to Venezuela, saw doctors. There was many, many scholarships. Many people went to study there. People who were getting arrested, people who were in a lot of fear of their lives, were given papers to go to Venezuela and just live and work there. So Venezuela has been a really large friend of the resistance in Colombia. But the Colombian government continues and will continue to be the enemy of the Bolivarian Revolution. They do everything they can. No country in Latin America does anything to destabilize Ecuador, Bolivia, and all of them, Venezuela, Cuba, Central America, El Salvador, Nicaragua. Colombia is the main destabilizer that the United States uses. And so it's very important to be aware of that and to be in solidarity with the people struggling in Colombia and the people struggling for a Bolivarian revolution and who want to bring Latin America together in self-determination and in sovereignty. So I'm going to end with a chant that's often used in Latin America. Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina la espada de Bolívar por América Latina. Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina la espada de Bolívar por América Latina. Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina la espada de Bolívar por América Latina.
Thank you,
thank you.
Thank you. As Martin has said before, this is a continent-wide struggle, and really it includes the United States too. Not the U.S. government, but the people of the United States have everything in common with the people of Venezuela and Mexico and all Latin America. Every time I talk, there's horns. Anyway, we're going to have speakers. Para la gente que está escuchando, pasando aquí, saliendo del trabajo o yendo al trabajo, estamos conmemorando la vida, la leyenda del comandante Hugo Rafael Chávez Frías, el presidente de 14 años de Venezuela, el gran héroe y revolucionario que cambió por siempre la historia de Venezuela y el azar de Latinoamérica. Porque con su valentía de 1992, cuando desafió a la dictadura, él convirtió las masas de Venezuela en una masa unida, luchando por las causas justas. Entonces, we're going to hear now from Harry from the International League of People's Struggle to talk about the struggle in the Philippines and how it relates to Venezuela. Please welcome Harry.
Thank you very much for letting me join you all today. I'm very happy to be celebrating the victory in Venezuela and honoring the two-year death anniversary, the sowing of Hugo Chavez back into the soil and to the people's struggles around the world. He continues, and the struggle in Venezuela continues to inspire revolutions, national liberation movements, people's struggles around the world. So I'm here representing a forming group, the International League of People's Struggle here in the United States. Several of us are going to Cuba for May 1. We're going there April 25th to May 3rd to join the May 1 celebration in Cuba. The labor leader from Kilusang Mayo Uno, the May 1st movement in the Philippines, will be a speaker at the May 1st celebration in Cuba. These victories in Latin America, from Cuba to Venezuela, throughout Latin America, continue to inspire us around the world. And as the speaker just said, our role here in the United States to lift up these struggles around the world is very important. We were at the Israeli consulate just yesterday to lift up the struggle of the Palestinian people against Netanyahu visiting the United States and trying to speak to Congress about his actions there, the war crimes he's committing. So we're exposing the war crimes he's committing. In the Philippines, just like in Colombia, as our comrade from Colombia mentioned, the U.S. uses the Philippines, the puppet government, to expand its war on terror, to wage the war on terror in Asia-Pacific region. We know that they're turning some resources and military forces to the Pacific Americas, Asia-Pacific, the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, the Pacific Pivot, they call it, and they've always used the Philippines. Since they colonized over 100 years ago, the Philippines as a jumping point for wars in Asia and around the world. So we are been resisting that for a whole century, and the people struggling in the Philippines is continuing to grow. We're inspired by revolutions around the world. Even though the Philippines is, like Colombia, one of the U.S.'s strongest allies, we're fighting against that, the National Democratic Liberation Movement in the Philippines. Just last month, the U.S. launched an operation. The FBI and the CIA used surveillance tactics and techniques. They're flying Predator drones, Orion spy planes over Mindanao, where the Muslim people and even the government had a peace agreement. But the U.S. went in, brought back a suspended Philippine National Police officer to do an operation to take out two war on terror targets identified by the FBI as the most wanted terrorists in the Philippines. They stepped all over the Philippine sovereignty, stepped over the government, but President Aquino signed off on it. He's a puppet leader in the Philippines who signs off on anything the U.S. wants in the Philippines, and we've been resisting against that and are right now calling for his resignation, truth, accountability, and justice against the Philippine President Aquino. So we need to continue to lift up these struggles around the world to wage, people's struggles against these reactionary governments, reaction around the world, and be in solidarity with movements that are lifting up the people's struggles in Venezuela. We are excited to go to Cuba and to continue to lift up this work here in the United States, here in San Francisco, so we can be in true solidarity with each other. So thank you for having me here today, and I'm honored to be here to celebrate the victory in Venezuela and continue it forward. Thank you.
Because it is a victory in Venezuela. Thank you so much, Terry. What we're going to do before it gets real dark, because in Venezuela, they really want to see all the solidarity actions that are taking place in the United States and worldwide. There's reporting from all over the world, everywhere, groups, countries, people, governments, and the progressive governments are celebrating Hugo Chavez's life and the Bolivarian Revolution. So after another one or two speakers, we'd like to ask everyone to come together and gather here for a big picture and a little shot of video. Because, it's hard to show everybody here, all gathered. So we'd like to do that and then continue the rally. It's not going to end it, but it's a good, strong point. So I think what we'll do now is hear from Richard Becker from the ANSA Coalition, Act Now to Stop War and End Racism. Thank you.
Thank you. The United States government is very concerned about human rights. When they can use it as a tool against another country. They're not so concerned about human rights when it comes to, say, Saudi Arabia or the Philippines. or so many other countries that we could name, including the state of Israel, whose blood-dripping war criminal leader was just here, as was mentioned, and we demonstrated against them the other day. They're not so concerned about civil society or human rights for the Palestinians, or for the people who live in Jordan. They weren't so concerned about human rights and civil society in Iraq. It's a very, very selective process. And because it's such a selective process, we know that it's a completely cynical process of determining who needs to have their human rights record improved. In fact, the United States government's own history makes clear that human rights is way, way, way down the list of priorities. You know, the real aim right now, and it's really some coincidence, that on the same day that Obama announced a change in the relationship with Cuba, not a complete change by any means, but that day when the Cuban Five were able to go home, the heroes of the Cuban people, that on the same day they announced new sanctions, intensified sanctions against Venezuela. What's the purpose of the sanctions? They're punishing Venezuela for human rights violations? I mean, that is the biggest joke. I mean, and they call, the top officials in the U.S. call the Maduro government a dictatorship. Equally ridiculous. They're using this, of course, to try to take Venezuela back. A country that has, in some say, the greatest oil resources in the world. That reason by itself would be enough from the point of view of the U.S. But that's, in fact, in this case, not the only reason. They want to break the Progressive Alliance, the ALBA Alliance, which is formed in Latin America, to break it so that there isn't another pole, that there isn't a pole of resistance that is strong and powerful in Latin America, because in Washington, whether it's Obama or Bush or Clinton or Bush or Reagan or Carter, and going all the way back to Monroe, they regard Latin America as their insulting term, their backyard. And it should remain always their backyard. And we join with the people of Venezuela, with the people of Cuba, with the people of Ecuador, with all of the people in Latin America, not just those who have governments that are in power, but everyone who is resisting. We stand with them because their struggle is our struggle, and our struggle is theirs, and together we can win. Thank you.
Important and relevant till today, and what are some of of the challenges that are happening right now. And I just want to speak a little bit from my heart, right, from the reality, the everyday reality that working class people are experiencing in Venezuela, and the big difference that they're experiencing now versus what they were living through 15, 20 years ago. And it's really amazing, you know, if we really believe in democracy, if we really believe in being able to participate in the decision-making of our city, of our region, of our country, then we need to invest in a revolution like is happening in Venezuela. In Venezuela, the working class people have been able to really participate in making changes in a lot of levels, right? Changes that are coming through the communal councils, that are coming through social movements that are being supported, that are coming through their local organizing, that are coming through the building of communes, that are coming through elections that happen every year, sometimes a few times a year. So there are so many ways in which people are really being able to truly participate in democracy. It's something that we really don't have experience of here. We think we have a democracy, but we really don't. We vote maybe once or twice every 4 years, and really usually the people who win are the people who are supported mostly by corporations, not even the people we really vote for, right? The number of people that come out to vote in Venezuela is about 80% or more of the electorate, and here it's about, what, 30%? So how is this a democracy, right? Who's really making the decisions? Are we making decisions? I don't really think so. So I think that for this reason and all the reasons that were mentioned before, the Bolivarian Revolution is still very, very important, very, very relevant, and we must support it. We must continue our solidarity work. And as a Venezuelan today, I continue to feel grief. You know, every month. It doesn't happen to me just in March, because we did lose a really big leader in his body. And what's amazing is that we didn't lose his legacy. We didn't lose his spirit. And that's also what's really, really inspiring about the Venezuelan people, who are continuing their organizing, who are continuing to carry that legacy, and we're continuing to carry the organizing that they've been doing since before Chavez anyway. The moment that I see any kind of criticism in the media around Maduro is not charismatic enough and Maduro is not the same as Chavez, that's not even the point, right? The point is not, is Maduro up there or who's the president? The point is that the people of Venezuela are organized and that they are making changes from the grassroots. And that's something that many of us here aspire to, and we don't even get to a quarter of it with the social movements that we are working on here, because there is so much repression in the United States. So thank you so much for being here, for supporting the Bolivarian Revolution, and for continuing to carry Chavez's legacy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carolina. And Carolina spoke about the working class of Venezuela. Well, we have a very major, big working class in the U.S. and San Francisco, which is struggling all the time, paying rent in this extravagant city, and fighting for education. We're going to hear now from Alan Fisher, who is a teacher at City College, which is under attack, and a member of, a leader in the American Federation of Teachers, Local 2121, and also a member of the Bay Area Latin America Solidarity Coalition, which is a sponsor of today. Please, if you're new to this rally, come sign up on the sign-up sheet to get notices of issues of any country in Latin America and Caribbean, including Haiti. Let's welcome Alan Fisher.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here to support the people of Venezuela and to oppose the intervention from the government of the United States, because international solidarity is very important. Working people are all in this together, and I just want to tell you about one struggle going on in this city regarding City College of San Francisco, which I've been working for 35 years. Today, I attended a demonstration with a couple hundred people from the community, students, immigrants, who are being denied education. And that has to do with the closing of one of the major campuses at City College, the Civic Center campus, which is the campus closest to the Tenderloin district of San Francisco, probably the poorest district in San Francisco. And hundreds of immigrant students were turned away with no prior warning a couple weeks ago. And the administration of City College, which has been installed by this accreditation commission that is attacking the college, they are denying the education to these students. And the people from the community came out today, and we were 200 strong, mostly people from the community, but also faculty members of City College, like myself. And we marched to City Hall to demand that they find a proper location for these hundreds of students who are now without English as a second language, computer classes, and other classes. That are still, actually, these are not credit classes. They are free to the people of San Francisco, and that's why this free education that is being provided is under such attack by the powers of our society, the corporate education agenda that we're fighting. And, you know, I just want to tell you about this struggle. On Tuesday, March 24th, we will be having a rally at our main campus, Ocean Campus, and we'd love if you could join us there. And what this got to do with Venezuela, it has to do with the struggle for education and healthcare and housing and a sustainable planet that we all must be part of, we all must be involved in. And that's why I'm here to lend my support for Venezuela tonight. Thank you.
En contraste, vemos en México, del país de donde yo soy, que Obama, el imperio de Estados Unidos, apoya. Y tanto le preocupan los derechos humanos a Estados Unidos, ¿por qué hacen caso omiso? ¿Por qué no dicen nada en relación a las miles de muertes que se dan día a día en México? Hay muertos. Todos los días vemos noticias de personas desaparecidas, de personas ajusticiadas, de personas masacradas, no solamente por los cárteles, sino también por el ejército. Pero por otra parte, los cárteles los maneja el gobierno. El Estado mexicano está coludido con los cárteles. ¿Por qué Estados Unidos? ¿Por qué Obama? ¿Por qué el Congreso no dice algo sobre Peña Nieto, que pasa su gobierno en asesinar, en reprimir y en quitar al pueblo mexicano las conquistas que se lograron años atrás con la Revolución Mexicana? Al contrario, Peña Nieto, como un llaverito de Estados Unidos, hace lo que le dicta el imperio, hace lo que le están dictando las corporaciones de Estados Unidos. Nos han vendido el petróleo, nos han vendido lo que es la energía, nos han reformado la constitución para hacer al país, a México, más a la altura de lo que necesita el gobierno de Estados Unidos, el imperio de Estados Unidos. Por eso, cuando se critica a Venezuela, la soberanía de Venezuela, nosotros nos reímos, nos da risa, porque es pura hipocresía. Cuando veamos que realmente el Estados Unidos, el gobierno, tiene una posición de crítica contra los asesinatos, contra la inmensa brutalidad que está ejerciendo el gobierno de México, de Peña Nieto, sería otra cosa, pero eso no lo vamos a ver, porque exactamente Peña Nieto está haciendo lo que le dicta el gobierno casi imperialista de Estados Unidos. ¡Fuera Peña Nieto! ¡Fuera Estados Unidos de México!
fuera Estados Unidos de Venezuela. Bueno, entre otras cosas, también les quiero avisar que este 8 de marzo estamos celebrando el Año Internacional de la Mujer. Durante más de 100 años se viene celebrando en todo el mundo el Día de la Mujer, que es un día de lucha, también es un día de la clase de mujeres, de la clase trabajadora y de las mujeres en general. Es un día que se ganó a base de lucha, no es un día que se otorgó solamente porque a alguien se le ocurrió. En fin, este domingo tenemos una actividad aquí en la 24 emisión. Vamos a tener una protesta y están todos invitados para que vengan a participar. Gracias. Perdón, el evento es de 2 de la tarde a 4.
Thank you. So tonight, for anyone who's just walking by, we're having a rally tonight, as it's happening all over the world, to celebrate the life of Hugo Chavez, the great revolutionary leader of Venezuela, who changed for always the history of that country and gave hope to all of Latin America. And today it's not just commemorating his passing, but his life and the future of Venezuela, which means our defense, our solidarity, our support, and to understand that the U.S. government, as much as they try to hide their role, they are responsible for the destabilization, the encouragement of the wealthy in Venezuela, the funding of the right wing, and who knows what else that the CIA and the U.S. Embassy is doing, but it's being uncovered. For those of you who are here and want to know how to learn more, you can read the website aporrea.org, A-P-O-R-R-E-A.org, or VenezuelaAnalysis.com, and other media, liberationnews.org. I have some articles about Venezuela. There's all kinds. BALIS, Bay Area Latin America Solidarity Committee Coalition, is a great group that has gathered together people from all different struggles, from Chiapas to Haiti to Guatemala to Honduras to Venezuela to Colombia, everywhere. I won't mention all 34 countries. But if you want to get involved with us, if you want to get notified, you have a sign-up sheet, please help us out. And there's an event tonight up in Marin, so we won't be long with this event. But I'd like to ask Frank Lada, who would like to please close the rally. Let's have a chat before that.
Alerta, alerta. Prepara de Bolívar por América Latina. Alerta, alerta.
Chávez vive, Maduro sigue.
Chávez vive, Maduro sigue. Chávez vive. Chávez sigue, vive. Chávez vive, vive.
Buenas tardes. Especialmente la razón que escogemos esta calle 24, compañeros, y especialmente si están saliendo de del trabajo. Este mensaje es para ustedes porque desafortunadamente vemos muchas veces a nuestra gente reaccionar de una manera que de veras no se puede entender por qué. Vivimos en la misión, hay desplazamiento, están corriendo todos los latinos, pero bien que quieren que trabajemos en el restaurante donde hay comida donde uno no puede comprar, bien que quieren que le estemos limpiando los hoteles donde uno no puede quedarse. Entonces, cuando vemos tanta pobreza, cuando vemos tanta lucha, cuando es tan difícil para nuestra gente latina aquí en Estados Unidos, ¿cómo es posible que uno, cuando escucha el nombre de Hugo Chávez, cuando escucha el nombre de Venezuela, el ejemplo de Venezuela, el ejemplo de Cuba, ¿cómo es que uno dice, esa gente? En Venezuela, actualmente, hace una semana, construyeron viviendas para 200,000 personas. Fíjense, 200,000 personas recibiendo vivienda gratuita. En San Francisco apenas somos 1,000,000. Ahí pueden traer todos los latinos de San José para que se queden aquí y se establezca otra vez la misión. Así de fácil. ¿Eh? En Venezuela lo que están haciendo, traen viviendas. Todo el petróleo que se ganaba, esos ganancias lo hicieron para el pueblo. Entonces, ¿por qué se molesta todo el venezolano que está aquí? Porque con el mexicano, yo soy mexicano, con el mexicano la gente lo cortaron porque el vendepatria de los presidentes vendieron toda la patria a México, digo a Estados Unidos, vendieron el petróleo a Estados Unidos, privatizaron el petróleo y lo usaron para los ricos. ¿Y qué pasó con todo el mexicano? El mexicano trabajador, pues lo forzaron para acá. Toda nuestra gente aquí está en los restaurantes, toda nuestra gente está limpiando los hoteles. Un trabajo que es extremadamente difícil, ustedes lo saben, si están bajando de la construcción, ustedes saben qué difícil es ese trabajo. En Venezuela no es lo mismo. En Venezuela el pobre y el trabajador está allá. La historia del pobre y el trabajador se encuentra allá. ¿Quién viene aquí? Bueno, el que paga $3,000 por el boleto. ¿Quién viene aquí? El que paga $3,000 para agarrarse una visa temporal, venir de vacaciones. Eso no es la realidad de nuestros pueblos. Por eso, en los medios se dice cada vez y critican. Critican a la gente. Critican a la gente que está luchando por su interés. Y para nosotros, los latinos de la misión, tenemos que estar en solidaridad con Venezuela. Tenemos que estar en solidaridad con la lucha latinoamericana. Porque la realidad nuestra está fea. Yo soy un maestro de la escuela pública aquí, Buena Vista Forest Man, y les puedo decir, como maestro de escuela pública, estamos jodidos. Nuestros niños no tienen futuro. Es muy feo decirle a nuestros niños, quizás vas a agarrar una educación de universidad, porque ya no existe. Tienes que agarrar un préstamo de $50,000, allá están dando educación gratuita. Cuando se enferman nuestros niños aquí, los tienes que llevar al cuarto de emergencia. Allá en Venezuela no. Todos reciben cuidado médico en su barrio. Entonces, compañeros, compañeras que están saliendo del trabajo, este mensaje es para ti. Cuando los pueblos se levantan y por fin están luchando en su interés, hay que estar en apoyo y no criticar. Porque, dicen, nosotros somos muy trabajadores y tenemos que ganar lo mismo aquí. Hay que usar el ejemplo de Venezuela para decirle aquí al rico que en vez de crear viviendas que cuestan de $300,000, que creen viviendas para el pueblo. Ese es el ejemplo de Venezuela. Porque nosotros podemos decir, si Venezuela puede, uno puede. Si los pueblos latinoamericanos pueden, en la misión se puede. Entonces, vamos a terminar esto. Agarre un volantito, inscríbase, infórmese, para que no esté escuchando ahí la Univisión y el Telemundo y el TLN en español, que le anda diciendo mentiras, que le anda diciendo que en Venezuela fue pobre, pero bien que no cubra el pobre aquí. Entonces, hay que poner esa contradicción. Brothers and sisters, we're going to be wrapping this up. If you haven't signed up or gotten the yellow sheet, please get one yellow sheet, sign up here. All we're saying is that you have to connect the struggle here. If you're not in support of Venezuela, well, that would make sense because you're probably supporting gentrification here too. Because you're probably supporting us getting kicked out here too. Venezuela is for poor and working people who finally stood up. And that's why we're here today. We set the example. We want the example of Venezuela because we want to stand up. We want to stop getting shot on 24th and Folsom because we're no longer welcome in our own neighborhood. That's what happened to Amilcar. Amilcar, the young man who was shot just a couple of days ago, because we're no longer welcome in this neighborhood. So don't believe the media that criticizes Latinos here, that's racist against Latinos here, and they go to criticize Venezuela. Okay, stand with us here, stand with us in Latin America, stand with us internationally. We're going to finish up with Chavez vive, Maduro sigue. Listo. Chavez vive!